nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back to Unit 3 of our course on quantum transport, and this is Lecture 5. Now, in the last two lectures, we developed a general method for finding the self-energy, and what we want to do in this lecture and the next is look at a couple of examples of how you'd apply this method to different problems. Now, earlier, if you remember, that was in lecture 2 of this unit, we talked about how you could find the self-energy using this method of basis transformations. So the idea is, if you have a contact like this and you think of it as 1D chain with these alphas connected by the betas, where alpha represents the entire column, beta is what connects one column to the next. And then for a square lattice like this, beta looks like an identity matrix, in the sense it's not only diagonal, but all diagonal elements are equal. Now, alpha has a non-zero upper diagonal and lower diagonal. But what you could do then is do a basis transformation here and make this diagonal, and beta, of course, still stays diagonal because it is essentially an identity matrix. And so once you have done a basis transformation, both alpha and beta can become diagonal. But this is not in general possible, because there are problems like, say, for example, graphene, where we don't really have a square lattice, we have this hexagonal lattice. And in this case, if you look at alpha, I guess you could try to use this unit, for example. You could think of that as one column. So this is one unit. That's another identical unit. And they're connected by these three betas. So beta would be these three things here. And this would be your alpha. And that would be another alpha. Now, in this case, beta is not an identity matrix. Here, beta was an identity matrix because every element in this column was connected to a corresponding element in that column. So 1 got connected to 1, 2 got connected to 2, 3 got connected to 3, and equally. Here it isn't quite like that. When you look at this column, you got many elements here, you know, 1 there, 1 here, 1 here, 1 here, etc. And this one is connected to that one. But this one's not connected to anything directly. I mean, that point on this column is not connected to any point on that column at all. Again, this one's connected to that. So what that means is when you try to write the beta, you won't get something like this. You won't get an identity matrix. You'd get connections for certain points and zeros for many others. And now if you try to diagonalize this alpha, the alpha you get for one of these units, you know, with all these hexagons that you could write down, if you try to diagonalize alpha, beta would become something else. I mean, to start with, it was diagonal, but because it wasn't an identity matrix, when you do a basis transformation, it won't stay diagonal anymore. And of course, if alpha and beta are both diagonal, then you can visualize the problem as lots of 1D problems in parallel, because they're both diagonal. But if one of them is not diagonal, then you don't have that luxury anymore. Then all these different chains get connected up, you see? So for graphene, that's why you couldn't really use the method we had in lecture 2. But what you could use is the method we just discussed in lectures 3 and 4. Because in lectures 3 and 4, what we said is, any structure that's described by alphas and betas, you could first find the surface Green's function by solving this matrix equation iteratively. And then once you have this surface Green's function, you could write the self-energy by taking this tau g, tau dagger. So numerically, that is how you could handle this problem. So if you think of a sheet of graphene where, you know, carbon atoms are at these points, as you know, and you could think of current flow in this direction. So that way, you'd have a contact here and a contact there. So you'd have a sigma 1 here and a sigma 2 over there. And those sigmas you could write down using this principle, right? And if you're interested in the details, you should look at the MATLAB codes that are in the notes, which describe how this problem is done. Now, so you could apply it to this problem, or you could apply it to, I guess, a different problem where the contacts are put in a different direction, for example. Now here, we call this usually the armchair edge. Now, why do you call it the armchair edge? Well, if the current is flowing in this direction, and if you look at this edge, I guess with a little imagination, you could see why someone might think of that as an armchair. See, it's somewhere where I guess you can imagine lying down on that. So that's why they call this an armchair edge. Now, when you go at 90 degrees to it, which means supposing instead of the current flowing this way, you put your contacts in this direction, so you have the current flowing this way, then you'd call it a zigzag edge, because now it doesn't require much imagination. If you look at this edge, it sure looks zigzag, right? So often these are the two limits that people talk about. Of course, you have to be careful because, of course, if this direction, you know, if in the transverse direction you have an armchair, then the longitudinal direction you'd have a zigzag. And so you have to be careful when you are referring to something as armchair, which side you are talking about, this one or that one. Okay? And of course, you could always have all kinds of other orientations because your contacts could be at an angle like this. It doesn't have to be like in this, you know, either this way or that way, like the two limits that I've shown. These are the most common ones, but there can be all kinds of different angles. And in each case, though, you could write down these alphas and betas. That is, what you'd have to do is set it up, figure out in a 1D chain what each unit should be. So figure out the alphas and betas. Then you'd have to solve this iteratively to find the surface Green's function, and then you could find the self-energy. So that would be the overall procedure. Now, I'll just show you some result that you could get. And as I said, the MATLAB codes are in the notes. So if you did the armchair edge, you get this black curve. And if you do the zigzag edge, you get the red curve. And what are we plotting here? Well, this is as a function of energy, the transmission. And this is for a ballistic conductor. That is, you're assuming, yeah, you have a ballistic graphene, you have one contact here, another contact there. So they are plotting this transmission, and we chose a specific width in this case. I think it's about like 15 units or so in this direction. And the two, an armchair and zigzag, were chosen such that the width is approximately the same. So in this case, the width corresponds to this direction. In this case, the width corresponds to that one. And again, the dimensions were chosen that they're about the same width. And what you find then is that when you look at the transmission as a function of energy, it's minimum right when it's in the middle. And then as you go in this direction, the number of modes increases, the density of states increases. And if you go below, again, same story, density of states increases, number of modes increases. And one point to note is that there's hardly any gap here. This is the important problem with graphene in general that people talk about, that unlike other semiconductors, there's no gap in the sense there isn't an energy range where you have like zero modes ordinarily, because graphite is the semi-metal. So it's like there's density of states on this side, density of states on this side. It's zero only right there. And that I guess, detracts from certain applications. Like if you wanted to make a transistor and you wanted to turn things off, you want to put your Fermi energy in the gap. And so not having a gap from that point of view is a disadvantage. But all this, of course, would come out automatically from this NEGF method that we have been discussing. As I stated before, that the power of this NEGF method is that you, if you know what you're doing, if you understand the procedure clearly, you can get numerical results without necessarily understanding all the physics of what is happening. And so you can use the numerics to improve your intuition and understanding. So what you should do is set it up properly, make sure you can calculate things numerically, and then see if you can understand what you calculate. So here, for example, one thing one could do is, that is, look at the semi-classical answer. So what do I mean by semi-classical answer? Well, the semi-classical one looks something like this. What we had discussed in unit one is that when you look at the band structure of graphene, there are these multiple valleys. So this was discussed in unit one. And if you go to one of these valleys, right around there, you have a linear dispersion relation where E is proportional to K, K being measured from that point. Right? And so if you want to look at one of these valleys, you could write E as a constant times Ka. Now, how would you calculate the number of modes? Well, roughly speaking, again, the idea is number of modes is the number of wavelengths that fit into the cross section. So if you have a graphene sheet whose width is W, and in the semi-classical description, it doesn't matter whether it's armchair or graphene or zigzag, because we're treating it as a kind of a continuum thing. So if it's of width W, then the number of modes is KW over pi. And that comes from this idea that how many half wavelengths fit into the width. These are the semi-classical arguments that we went through in part A of the course. Okay. So if you do that, there's KW over pi. Now, why the two? Well, two is because in graphene, there are these two valleys. And as we discussed again in unit one, there are kind of six valleys within a first Brillouin zone. But each valley is a one-third valley. So overall, it's like two valleys, one around here and one around here. So the number of modes is 2 times Kw over pi. And now if you use this expression, you could replace K in terms of E, and then you get this expression. So you get the number of modes as a function of energy, and it's a straight line. So that's what is plotted here. That's this straight line. So this is what you'd have got from a simple semi-classical argument. You'd get that straight line. And you can kind of see that the actual result follows that straight line, roughly, at least at low energies. And we don't expect it to fit at high energies anyway, because this dispersion relation only holds for small energies around that valley. So you don't really expect it to hold out here. But the interesting point is, until here, it holds quite well. See? The straight line. And of course, what the straight line isn't showing is all these steps, because the straight line is assuming, I mean, treating this just as a number, not taking its integer value or anything. So you don't expect the steps, you just get the straight lines. Now, again, the point to note is that when you do the numerical method, though, you don't have to make all these arguments. You don't have to understand how many valleys graphene has, for example. So here, in order to get the semi-classical answer, I had to put this 2 in. Where did the 2 come from? Well, 2 because there's 2 valleys. How do I know there's 2 valleys? Well, because when you look at the first Brillouin zone, there's actually this 6 minima, and each one is a 1/3 valley, and so on. Remember, we had a long discussion. So it takes a lot of understanding, lot of discussion to come up with this expression. Right? That's kind of what we did in unit 1. But numerically, you see, this plot came without understanding any of that. The numerically, how did we get it? Well, we just set up graphene, wrote down the alphas and betas, found the surface Green's function, found the sigma, and numerically that's how we got it. So when you have a new material where you don't understand all this yet, you could still use the numerical method. But then what you should do is go through all the arguments properly and see if you can understand what you're calculating. Now, numerically, the other thing you can do is, easily is, instead of graphene, you could be looking at carbon nanotubes. You see, the difference between graphene and carbon nanotubes is, graphene is just a sheet like this, whereas in carbon nanotubes, it's rolled up in the, like a straw. Right? So you have this periodic kind of boundary condition along the width. So here what I've shown is graphene. In carbon nanotubes, what would happen is this end would get connected to that end again. Now numerically that's easy enough to do. That is, when you write the alpha, you just connect this end to that end. That's all. Similarly, for zigzag edge, you'd connect this end to that end. Think of it as if it's rolled around. So numerically, you could just change the alphas and betas. And if you look at the MATLAB code, just takes one line to do that, you know, where you make that change. And if you do that, you'll get a different transmission. You see, so we are plotting the same thing here, transmission. But now you'll notice the steps are not quite as fine as this one. Roughly speaking, with periodic boundary conditions, you tend to get less number of steps, but the steps itself are bigger. So again, it follows roughly the same semi-classical line, but the details are now different. And when people look at small structures, indeed, they see these differences experimentally as well. So that was then, intended to illustrate how you apply this new method that we talked about in lectures 3 and 4, this general method for finding the self-energy. And that's this graphene example. What we'll do in the next lecture is talk about a different example involving magnetic fields. So we'll go back to the square lattice that we had. And for a square lattice, I mentioned earlier, you can usually get these simple answers by this method of basis transformation, but not when there's a magnetic field involved. So what we'll look in the next example, in the next lecture we'll look at, is how you can do problems that involve magnetic fields, small magnetic fields or high magnetic fields, but in a square lattice. Thank you.